of Center Point Church. So glad that you can join us this Sunday. Let's get ready to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus, for He is good all the time. Amen.
When all I see is a battle, You see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, You see
Thank you, Father. Yes, Lord, there is no other name, no other name that holds power, no other name that makes way for victory, for breakthrough, no other name, Lord. We praise that name and lift that name high. We thank you so much, God, for this time where we can enter into your presence singing your praises, Lord. We do all of this for your glory. We love you. We thank you, and in Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen.
Hey everyone, welcome to Centerpoint. My name's Brett, I'm the online campus pastor. So glad that you are here with us today, wherever you're watching from, as we've gathered together online as one to worship God. We're gonna continue our worship in a few moments. We've been spending some time worshiping with music and song, and we're gonna be continuing that worship in just a few moments. But before we do, if you're here for the very first time checking out Centerpoint, we're so glad that you're here with us, that you've made us part of your day. Would you do us a huge favor and let us know you're here by filling out our digital Connect card. Check out that Connect card, fill it out with as much information as you feel comfortable sharing with us. We'd love to get to know you a little bit, see how we could serve you, connect with you this week. So do that today at some point, check out the Connect card. Also, if you're here and you're prepared to worship through giving, remember the best way to give online is to go to cpchurch.com/give, or if you've downloaded our app and you have it on your smartphone, you have options to give there as well. Now, we are in the middle of our newest sermon series called Freedom, and we're going to be hearing from Pastor Brian McMillan. He's our lead pastor here in just a few moments. But before we do that, I want to send it over to a special announcement that we have, some news about our Central Nassau campus. So let's send that over, and I'll see you guys in the chat. God bless.
We are excited to announce that on the first Sunday of October, 10-2-22, we will be launching Centerpoint Church Westbury.
Hello, everyone. We have some exciting news for you regarding Centerpoint Church's search for campus number 7, a location for campus number 7. Well, Centerpoint Church people prayed, we fasted, we believed by faith, and we waited on God's timing. And we are excited to announce that on the first Sunday of October, 10-2-22, we will be launching Centerpoint Church Westbury, campus number 7, right here in the heart of Central Nassau County. God moved in a big way, and we will be utilizing this beautiful, newly renovated, brand new building, 535-seat middle school auditorium with classrooms right next to the auditorium, beautiful classrooms for our kids, literally 60 seconds or less off of the Post Avenue exit of the Northern State Parkway. And as you know, we are excited to take the love of God found in and through Jesus into the Westbury area and the surrounding communities, into new areas on Long Island, to further Centerpoint Church's mission to give everyone on Long Island, from Brooklyn to Montauk, multiple opportunities to hear and respond to Jesus. So get excited. God bless you all, and have a great day.
In Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free.
To follow the law or to not follow the law, that is the question of our series. Are any of you strict rule followers, or do you see rules a little bit more like me as suggestions? I gotta be careful with this because we have so many law enforcement agents in our church. But, you know, there's a lot of rules out there that you're like, are they rules? You know this. If you go to a stop sign and it has the white perimeter around it, we all know it just means yield, right? And if you pull up to a light and it's turning yellow, you know that just means to accelerate, right? You don't stop, you go faster. I need to be careful because my son Brady's 16. He's about to get his driver's permit, so I got to be careful what I teach him at this point. But here's the thing. I'm the kind of guy that I see a lot of laws as suggestions. You kind of weigh it, right? What's the pro and con if I follow this? For example, do you guys remember when Pokemon Go first came out in 2006? That was one of the best summers of my life. I won't even pretend. My family was all into Pokemon Go. We were together all the time playing Pokemon Go. We were in Long Beach a lot of our times. A lot of good Pokemon in Long Beach. And so we would be down there. And there was this one time I was with my youngest son, Connor. He was about 8 years old at the time. It was actually Gen 2 when it came out. So it was the second year. Connor was 8. And how Pokemon Go would work, if you never played, is that there would be this shadow of a Pokemon figure. That means you haven't caught that one yet. And the whole goal of Pokemon is to kind of catch them all. That's what you got to do. And so we saw this one Pokemon and we assumed where it was in an area that simply said private property, no trespassing. Now, listen, I want to be the best that the world has ever known. So when I see this opportunity to get this Yama, this Pokemon that's like a dragonfly. It's a bug flying Pokemon. I'm like, I'm going to do it. I'm like, son, I wanted him to see how dedicated I am. Let's hop the fence and go get it. And I thought he'd be excited, right? Like, yeah, dad, you're so cool. Let's do it. And he's like, no, the sign. No trespassing, dad, you can't. And you have that moment as a parent. What is the lesson to be learned here? Is the lesson that is right, son? You follow the law, or is the lesson, you need to be a great Pokemon trainer and do whatever it takes. Well, I'm a pastor, guys, so you know what I did. I took his phone, I jumped the fence, I caught that Pokemon, came back, and he just looked in awe and shock like, you are so bad. Laws are interesting. And so what we're doing in the series is we're answering the question, does a Christian need to follow the Old Testament law? We're coming right off the series, Loving Leviticus. And if not, what does this teach us as a church today? So let's get into it. Let me give you a quick recap. We're in the book of Galatians. It's a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote addressing this very question. And last week, we spent our time in chapter 1 into the beginning of chapter 2. And we learned that the Apostle Paul, who wrote this letter to these churches, is irate. He's angry. He's deeply concerned for this predominantly Gentile, non-Jewish church that he planted on his first missionary journey. And he starts off this letter just getting right to the heart of it when he says in chapter 1, verse 6 and 7, he says, you are so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. You see, there was a group called the Judaizers that were preaching that to be a real Christian, you must still practice the Jewish law. They are saying that without the law, you can't really be a Christian. You can't really be right with God. That this is still a package deal with what they've always done. So let's pick up where we left off last week. Paul is continuing his argument. By the way, if you're new or you've missed last week, I'd encourage you to go online, go to our YouTube channel, watch it so you can see this flow of what Paul is saying. And Paul's now starting by sharing a story from his past, a past moment that he had with the Apostle Peter. Chapter 2, verse 11 of Galatians. It says, when Cephas, Peter's name, came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group, these Judaizers. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. Now you read this at first, like, oh man, that's kind of cold. You know, he's no longer eating with his Gentile buddies. He's now only eating with his Jewish buddies. You know, that sounds wrong. But I want you to see that there's something bigger that's going on here, because this isn't like high school when you just kind of sat with your crew. You know, you have your jocks over here, your anime crew over there, right? You got your chess club sitting there and your band club sitting over here. And they just sat with the people that they had common interests with. It's far more than that. Because you see, eating together in this day and age was actually more of a pledge of community. It was a belonging. It was true fellowship. Eating together meant that you were equals, and to not eat with someone meant that you were above them or you were ashamed of them. It's why when Jesus was eating with the sinners, it ended up on TMZ. Everyone was so shocked by it. Like, you're saying, like, you're equal to these people, you care about them, you're not ashamed of them, you're willing to take their shame on to you. And it says that even Barnabas, who was with Paul on the first missionary journey, which means he helped plant this church in the first place with all of these Gentiles, is now only eating with the Jewish Christians. Verse 14. He says, when I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in front of all of them, you are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? This is the heart of what we're talking about. So you see, there was this start of a first tier and second tier Christianity as a result of these Judaizers. The better ones, the real Christians, were the ones who followed the law. And if they were Jewish and following the law, then they were the ultimate Christians. And Peter, when these Judaizers weren't around, it was just Peter and these Gentile Christians in this church. He didn't care about the law. He wasn't worried about the dietary law, the Apostle Paul is saying. He's having bacon-wrapped shrimp. And then suddenly the Judaizers are there. He's like, oh, no, that's wrong. I'm not going to eat that. I'm going to be here, and I'm only going to eat kosher. And suddenly, Peter's on his best law behavior to not have to deal with any backlash. Verse 15, Paul goes on and says, we who are Jews, because remember, the Apostle Paul, as we learned last week, was a Pharisee. He was a religious leader, a Jewish religious leader before coming to Christ. We who are Jews by birth and not sinful Galatians. By the way, I love that Paul uses sarcasm because it justifies my own, you know? Not these sinful Galatians. I love Paul. He says, know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. Because by the works of the law, no one will be justified. But if in seeking to be justified in Christ, we Jews find ourselves among the sinners, doesn't that mean that Christ promotes sin? And this was an argument from the Judaizers. Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroy, then I really would be a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law so that I may live for God. I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if the righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. So if the law was the answer, then why did Jesus come in the first place? If the law was the answer, then why did Jesus have to die? Why did he have to sacrifice himself on behalf of our sin? Now, as I read all that, if you're scratching your head a little bit, you're newer to church, you're newer to faith, and you hear verses 15 to 21, you might be thinking, that sounds like just a lot of religious ramblings. Like, I don't get, what does that actually mean? Like, what does this mean for my life? Well, let me try to explain it. Because the Apostle Paul's argument really hangs on verse 16. If you understand verse 16, I would argue you understand all of Galatians, and probably you really understand what Christianity is all about. It's a pivotal verse. And so let's look at it again. Galatians chapter 2, verse 16, where he says, know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Christ Jesus. So we, too, have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. Because by the works of the law, no one will be justified. Now here in this one verse, Paul uses the word justified three times. Clearly, this word justified is the heart of the issue, which is really the heart of the Christian faith. You get this wrong, you get everything wrong. So it sounds like a pretty big deal, right? Like, we need to understand, what does he mean by justified? See, the word for justified in the Greek is translated to make morally right. If you are justified by something, you are now made morally right. To justify means that we now get to be in a right relationship with God. We are now accepted by God. It's a relational term. We see our sin made us, made being right with God absolutely impossible. Sin made it so it wasn't ever going to happen. If there is sin in your life, there is now a division between us and God. Have you ever lied? Anyone out there ever lied since you were a child? You lied, guess what? It's over. The sin of that lie is now preventing you from a relationship with God. You lust, done. You hate, it's finished. You break any of the Ten Commandments, let alone any of the other defined sins in scriptures, then you broke them all. And as a result, you have a completely broken, no, let me rephrase that, decimated relationship with God as a result of sin. The separation is there, which means everyone is in the same boat. Everyone has sin and is separated from God. We all need to be justified before God, to be made morally right before God, to heal this relationship. And here's what Paul is saying. A person cannot be justified by the law. The law is not going to fix this problem, this reality of sin in our life. The law can't fix that relationship with God. The only way that you can have a relationship with God is through faith in Christ alone. Amen? The only way. Pastor and author David Platt says this. He says, justification is the gracious act of God by which God declares a sinner righteous solely through faith and faithfulness of Jesus Christ. And it's the only way. Paul says in Romans 5:1, since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And the only way to have this peace and this relationship that is broken and divided is through Christ. It is it. Why is this such a big deal? Well, it means something so important, friends. Don't miss what I'm about to say. There are not many roads to God. I know that is an unpopular thing to say. I know culturally, every time I bump into someone and I tell them that I'm a pastor, they're like, oh, that's so great. That's wonderful. You know what I believe? I believe that there's so many ways to God. I hear it every time that I mention that I'm a pastor. That's just where the conversation flows. I know that's what culture says and wants to believe, but hear me, the Apostle Paul and all of Scripture is saying the exact opposite. There are not many roads to God. Not all roads lead to God. Being a good person isn't enough. Being a religious person isn't enough. Paul is saying, Scripture is saying, the only way to be made justified, the only way to be made justified, friends, is through Jesus Christ. The only way to spend eternity with God is through Jesus. The only way to be declared righteous is through faith in Christ. Friends, Jesus is the only way. He's it. He's it. And here's what I love about it, and we're going to get into this next week. Here's what I love about Jesus. He's not saying, I only want a certain kind of person. I only want people with this background. I only want people who have been this good. No, the gospel, the good news of Jesus, is open to everyone. No matter who you are, no matter what your religious background, no matter what your past, no matter how evil you have even been, no matter your race, no matter your gender, no matter anything, this gospel of Christ is given to all. That's Paul's argument here in Galatians. He's like, no, even the Gentiles, this isn't just the Jewish Messiah for the Jewish people. Jesus came so that everyone can come to him. No one is held back. Anyone can come to him. But friends, hear me. He is the only way. Which then, if you're here, you're new to church, you hear that, it will culturally rub you the wrong way. I'll admit that. I want you to know, I get it. If I wasn't a Christian, I heard that, I'd be like, wait, what? The only way? What about that faith? They seem good. What about that faith? They got a prophet. But if it is true, you have to at least wrestle with that, because we're not saying like this is kind of an important thing. Like, you should just live on a vegan diet because meat is bad, right? It's not like, oh, that's what you should do because it's unhealthy if you don't. I still don't believe you, by the way. I know it's not true. I'm going to eat meat. And we like kind of like, wait, no. What scripture is saying, what Paul is saying, is that this is about eternity. This isn't just about a choice in life that, yeah, may have some different consequences for how things play out. No, he's saying that this is the most important thing that you can ever wrestle with. And if you want to give any credence to the validity, at least the potential validity, even if you're very skeptical of the Word of God and of Scripture, and is it actually a book from God to us to know who he is and how to get to him? Friends, if there's even a 3-4% chance that you're willing to give scripture that it is something that is holy and something that is supernatural and something that is from God, you can't just blow this off. Because we're talking about life and death. And friends, I want you to know, as the church, as Christians, this is why we can never get lazy or lethargic with letting people know who Jesus is and what he has done for us. Because we're not just giving people options of their favorite foods. We're talking about eternity, with or without God. I still get frustrated when some people, like, oh, Brian, why are you starting another campus? You guys, you're just so aggressive. You just want to build the organization. Yeah, I do love the fact that we get to do what we do. It does fit the personality that God has given me, but make no mistake about it. Why do we want to go Brooklyn to Montauk? It is for one reason only, because Christ has called the church to do so. He has. And it may look different ways. You don't have to be a multi-campus church, but Christ has called us as his people to go and give everyone multiple opportunities to hear and respond to the gospel. And I'm going to do it as aggressively as Christ has allowed for me as a leader and us as a church to do that. Why? Because we see what the stakes are. They're not small. There's nothing more important. Friends, at the end of the day, Jesus is the only cure for the sin within our life. And we will never slow down letting people know that there is, in fact, a cure. His name is Christ. Now let's get back to Paul's point. We can never add or subtract anything from this gospel. That is not our place. Yet unfortunately, sometimes in the church, we do add to it. We try to make it gospel plus. We're like, oh, I like the gospel. That is good news. But let's add something else to it to just kind of maybe solidify people's faith in Christ. Let's just put a little bit more in there. Let's make them work a little bit harder. This whole faith by grace thing is a little too simplistic. You just ask Christ for forgiveness of the sin in your life and it's gone, and now you're a follower of Christ. Let's add some. And I believe for a lot of people, by the way, it's a desire to try to be faithful to how they interpret Scripture. But I believe they're interpreting Scripture wrong. I'll give you a couple of examples of what I see in certain churches and denominations and circles. There's some churches that say, hey, if you really want to be a Christian, you really want to be saved, here's how you do it. You need to have salvation and faith and baptism. It's the gospel plus baptism. And I understand the argument scripture says to be saved and be baptized, but I gotta tell you, if baptism, a physical act, is essential for salvation, guess what we now have? We now have grace plus works. Is baptism important? 100%. We have a baptism coming up in a week and a half. I believe every follower of Christ, after the moment they put their faith in Christ, must be baptized. It is a command from Jesus. You have to be baptized. It is part of the deal. But if the moment you accept Christ, you're driving home that day, there's a baptism 3 weeks away, you register for it, but you die before it, you're like, I wasn't baptized. What happens to me now? There's good news. Salvation is through faith alone, not by works, so that no man can boast. It is critical, but it is not equivalent to salvation. It is part of the process after we put our faith in Christ. Speaking in tongues. Some of you come from a charismatic Pentecostal background. You may have come from a little bit more of an extreme church version of it where they say, unless you're speaking in a supernatural language that God gives you through the Holy Spirit, you're not actually saved. Until that moment of the words coming from your mouth from an angelic heavenly language, then salvation has not happened yet. Do I believe speaking in tongues is real and people still do it today? I do, actually. I do believe that that can happen. I believe it's one of the many gifts that we can receive through the Holy Spirit. Does that mean that you are saved in that moment or it's a sign of salvation? Absolutely not. You put your faith in Christ for the forgiveness of your sin, and salvation has entered your house that day. Some circles, it's the gospel plus confirmation and first communion and the sacraments. Until you have all these three things, you're not actually a Christian. No. Is taking the Lord's Supper important? Is the Eucharist important? Absolutely. We're commanded to do it. It's why it's for us, we call it an ordinance. Some call it a sacrament. But yeah, we baptize, we take the Lord's Supper. It is really important in our growth and worship and obedience to Christ. But is it salvation? No, it's not. It happens as a result of salvation. The last one I want to mention, I'm just throwing in there because I've been looking for an opportunity to throw this in there and just rile some people up. If 10% of our church isn't mad at me, I'm not doing my job as a pastor. I think one of the biggest dangers to the gospel plus happening in the American church right now is Christian nationalism. It's the gospel and the Constitution. It's the gospel plus. I'm not even going to tell you who he is because I don't want to give him any stage time in himself, but there's someone with a loud podium right now, and he said this last week. He says, I always tell people, a pastor or priest, that they cannot stand there at the pulpit and preach the Bible without the United States Constitution. And what they need to do is they need to be talking about the Constitution from the pulpit as much as the Bible. And crowds are clapping, churches are clapping to this idea, this notion. Because, you know, when Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount, he started, we the people. Jesus started the Christian faith for the sake of America. Now hear me, friends. You can be patriotic, but you cannot combine nationalism and Christianity. That is a very dangerous gospel plus that I think is crippling the church in America right now. I normally don't read verbatim something I wrote, but I sent this to our staff this past week, and I just want to read it to you because I want you to hear what I am and am not saying. I said, here's the difference between being a patriot, being patriotic, versus a Christian nationalist. A Christian that is a patriot loves and appreciates their country, and they live as a Christian in their country. They try to be a good citizen, they vote their convictions, and they live out their faith while always knowing that they are a spiritual foreigner and alien in the land in which they live. A Christian nationalist, though, combines faith and country. They don't distinguish the two. They try to make the Bible justify a type of new Israel. They see their country over the kingdom of God. They care more about their own welfare than that of the global church and mission of God. They make an idol out of their country and politics, and they politicize Jesus. Friends, the church must care about the world and must care about the gospel going forth to the world. It is not about one country. It is not saying that we are the best. It is realizing God cares as much about the soul in China as he does in Mexico, as he does in the Ukraine, as he does in America. And that we are the church, a global movement of foreigners and aliens in the world that we find ourselves for the advancement of the good news of Jesus. That is our first identity. And everything else is secondary. I'm patriotic. I don't want to live anywhere else. I love that I'm an American. But my identity is a Christian. And it is in Christ first and foremost. It is not gospel plus America. It is gospel and I am an American. Two different things. We need to remember the order. Amen. We must keep the gospel, the gospel. I see three warnings for the church in what Paul is teaching us here today that we at Centerpoint need to remember. I'm gonna go through them real fast. Here's the first one. We have to make sure that we never confuse salvation with the process of sanctification. Sanctification is the process of becoming like Jesus. Sanctification happens once we put our faith in Christ. It doesn't happen in reverse. And so as a result, have you ever noticed like you're trying to talk to someone who has not put their faith in Christ, they're not a Christian, and you try telling them to live a certain way that the Bible says to live, but they aren't a Christian, they're not filled with the Spirit of God, they're like, you're a fool. Why on earth would I live with that level of morality that I don't even agree with? I'll tell you why they don't want to live by it, because why would they? Why would you if you didn't have Christ? You think I would be this version of me if I didn't have Jesus in my life? You know, there's no way. Like, this is not who I am in the flesh. This is only who I am as a result of the Spirit of God. And that's the process of sanctification, of becoming like Christ, because the work of the Holy Spirit in my life. And the same is true with you. And a lot of times, I think we want people to start being sanctified and going through sanctification prior to salvation. It doesn't work that way. Salvation is first. Sanctification is second. Becoming like Jesus is second. That's why baptism is second. That's why taking the Lord's Supper is second. That's why learning and growing in holiness is second. All of that is secondary, and we can't combine them into one. Salvation is a moment. Sanctification is a life. Salvation is the gift of God. Sanctification is us working out our faith in fear and trembling before our God. The second thing I want you to know is that we need to make sure that we don't mandate rules to Christianity that the Bible doesn't mandate. It can be very easy sometimes to just start making everything super black and white. And a lot of times there may be a little bit more gray. There may be some conviction that you have that a brother and sister in Christ doesn't have, and you can't point to a specific verse, and you're like, I feel like this is right. And they're like, well, I feel like this is right. Well, it gets very dangerous when you say, the Lord says, when you can't back it up in Scripture. Now, that doesn't mean there aren't things in today's day and age that the Lord didn't outright say, because our culture is so different, that Scripture does say. For example, do you know that there was no internet when Jesus walked the earth? It's very true. No internet. There was no internet pornography when Jesus walked the earth. He never spoke about internet pornography once in all of the Gospels. Did you know that? But I can promise you this, pornography is a sin. Right? Because I'll tell you why. No one watches pornography for the storyline. They're not. They're watching it because of lust. I can tell you very clearly all throughout Scripture that lust is a sin. And so I can say pornography is a sin because it's all about lust. And as a result of that, we can see. But there's other things that we may wrestle with a little bit here. And so we have to make sure that we're not mandating rules to Christianity that the Bible doesn't mandate. Third and final, we need to make sure that we don't allow traditions to become more important than Scripture. And this is what led to the entire Reformation, the Protestant break from Catholicism, and all that has unfolded. The reality is any church, Catholic, Protestant, you name it, Lutheran, Methodist, non-denominational, evangelical, any church, any group of Christians can easily start to say our tradition is just as important as the Word of God. It never is and it never can be. And no one can claim it to be. Not a pastor, not a bishop, not a pope. There is sola scriptura, scripture only, to direct the affairs of the life of the church. And so we need to make sure that we never say that this tradition is equal to the word of God, because the word of God can stand fine on its own. Amen. Let me leave you with this final picture, this quick analogy. How many of you love a good baby sea turtle, right? We just watched Finding Nemo. Favorite part of Finding Nemo is just a little sea turtle doing his thing. Here's a quick little picture of a sea turtle. And here's what happens with sea turtles. You know, they're endangered. The reality is a mom will come and lay her sea turtle eggs in the sand. And when they finally hatch, the sea turtles come out. And the way that God has made the sea turtle is to find its way back to the water. There's this natural compass that has to do with light that leads the sea turtle back to the ocean. And as a result, particularly at night, if the sea turtles hatch then, they need to get right to the water, because if they don't, they're going to die. The problem is we have so much natural light now that it throws off this part of the baby sea turtle's natural instinct, especially LED lights, for whatever reason, with the way that they just emit light. And we all know about light pollution. We know in Long Island there is no such thing as stars in Nassau County. Isn't that true? You look up, there's not a cloud in the sky. You're like, stars don't exist. I'm looking up right now. The world is flat, no stars. It's just the reality of the world that we live in, because that is what I can and cannot see. Barely see the moon sometimes because the city can be so bright and there's such light pollution. Well, that's what happens to the baby sea turtles. There's all this man-made light and they are drawn to that instead of the light that's supposed to draw them to the ocean. As a result, they end up in streets and the opposite. They die of starvation. Other animals eat them. Possums pick them up and are delicious. I don't know where that came from. It's been a long day already. But my point is that the sea turtle doesn't make it to where it's going to live, where it's going to have life, because of the man-made light. This is what we often do in the church. We end up making so much man-made light, so much religion, so much tradition, so many things that are the gospel plus, that we are actually killing people, spiritually speaking. They're not getting the real, pure gospel that the Apostle Paul talks about. They're not getting the real light of Christ. And we are like the baby sea turtles, just heading the wrong direction. So as a church, as the people of God, we have to understand why it's so important to keep the gospel first and foremost without any altered light ideas, anything that can twist, pervert, or wreck the truth of the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen, church. Will you stand with me? Worship team, will you come on out? God, I want to just pray for our church, and I want to thank you for the opportunity to share this message that you put upon my heart there's a lot in here, God, a lot that can confuse or frustrate or maybe even anger someone. But God, may we be a church that only pursues the purity of your light. God, we never want a gospel plus here at Centerpoint. We want the gospel, and then we want to learn how to live sanctified lives. And if there is anyone out there that for maybe the first time you heard and you understood who Jesus really is, and you're like, I want that. That's not what I thought Christianity was. I didn't think it was about having a right relationship with God. I didn't realize what Jesus had done for me. That's what I want. I need that. Brian, especially if it's as important as you say it is, then I don't want to leave here today without it. Well, friend, if that's you, I want you to say a prayer with me. You can just say it in your mind and your heart, or you can say these words out loud. But I want to give you a moment to pray to God. So say this with me. God, I come before you right now. And I thank you for sending your son, Jesus, for me. Jesus, thank you for being on the cross for me. Jesus, forgive me. Well, you know, if you're there along with me right now, I truly believe that you are now made righteous before God. I really believe in this very moment, if there was a prayer of faith, that you are now justified before God. You now have a right relationship before God. You are now made morally right before him. And he's going to show you what it means now to live your life for him. And your life will never be the same again. I would love you. I encourage you to go in the back after the service. Go to our prayer team. Let them know. Fill out one of the connect cards. Let us know. But the most important thing that could ever happen in your life happened today. Amen, church. And so, God, I just thank you that you continue to use Centerpoint. God, we are not the best church on Long Island. We do not have everything right. But if there's one thing that can ever be said about us, may it be that we are faithful followers of Jesus Christ. Jesus, we love you, and we thank you for your gift to us. We worship you and we praise you. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Thank you so much, friends, for being here today. Let's close and worship together.
Cross is full.